In this lesson, we are looking at comparing ecosystems. It is just one specific dot point, and we're going to really break it down. So let's actually break down the statement that we're looking at. This dot point is asking us to compare ecosystems, and we understand that QCAA's definition of compare is to find similarities, differences, and significance. We are using abiotic factors, which we are familiar with, species interactions, and Simpson's diversity index. So again, all three things we have seen before, we understand, and we are comparing these in the context of temporal and spatial scales. Okay, now this is the new information for us, so we have to discuss what temporal and spatial scales are in ecology. In this context, a temporal scale refers to a time scale, so it can be communicated in years or a lifespan of years relative to the generation in the time of an organism. And the spatial scale refers to the geographical physical space, the size, and the difference between those ones. So to compare ecosystems, we obviously need to collect some data through sampling, and we've mentioned these types of data that we can collect, so species richness, relative abundance, percentage cover, percentage frequency, and measuring our biodiversity using SDI. So even if there are biases, even if our biases are completely eliminated and our sampling techniques are impeccable, our sampling is still only representative of a moment in time and space. So for example, if we sample in the day, we might not be able to actually confidently count nocturnal animals. If we sample during winter in some areas, you know, you might not be able to sample hibernating animals or dormant plants which lay under the soil. And if we sample the shoreline of an aquatic ecosystem, are we seeing all of the marine life in the bay area as well? And all of this can be misleading to our assumptions about a particular ecosystem. So to thoroughly compare an ecosystem across the temporal scales and the spatial scales, we sort of have to imagine that we have the ability to continuously sample, continuously over time and continuously throughout the space. So to do this, obviously, that's going to be quite a large scale operation, which is not really very practical. Now, if we look at ecosystems in a spatial perspective, we have to consider size. And ecosystems exist at a micro, a meso, and a macro level. A micro encompasses the local area and those biomes. The meso is areas within continents, and the macro are entire countries or entire continents. Now, at a bigger picture level, we assume that ecosystems, are represented by the quadrats or whatever it is we're doing. So if we're looking at an entire macro ecosystem, we have to assume that all of the micro ones collectively, and it's that important word collectively, are representative of the macro ecosystem there. So despite the spatial scale, right, we consider the diversity of a particular ecosystem is similar at all levels. And this is because SDI is calculated using a ratio of the species present to the number of individuals in their population. In terms of species interactions, generally the ratio, say, of producers to consumers is pretty similar at all levels. It doesn't matter what level you're looking at. Since other species interactions work relatively the same way, say in a food web, for example, this is pretty similar across all spatial levels as well. Abiotic factors, however, they are going to massively differ from micro level to macro level. So if you consider even a tiny section of the ecosystem in your own backyard, you know, there'll be parts that receive heaps of sunlight, heaps of rain, have different availability of space. You know, you might have a fence there, so plants get stopped with their growth. But abiotic factors vary considerably across any spatial level, especially all those different scales. In Australia, February temperatures alone can range from single figures like 2 degrees down in Tasmania, where snow can be produced, to the high 40s. So it's rare to find homogeneous abiotic factors at a macro level. So comparisons are usually made at the micro and the meso level only. Some factors you might need to consider. If you're talking about a terrestrial ecosystem, soil, so many characteristics of soil that you can look at, climate, which obviously encompasses quite a lot as well, and the physical space in the area, obviously. And in a marine situation, you're also adding in there, say, light, depth, turbidity, oxygenation of the water, temperature, water flow, and pH. So there's a lot going on there. If we look at ecosystems through the lens of a temporal scale, we consider change over time. So similarly, from our spatial scale, our temporal scales range from very small to very large, or in this case, short to long. So our short term, obviously talking about days, our midterm are seasonal, and our long term can be either years or even stretching into decades or centuries. Now, at a temporal level, our biodiversity differs quite substantially. So if we consider when in the day we sample, we have to consider nocturnal species, like we mentioned before, or just any disturbance to a habitat during the time of sampling, right? Just even walking into the habitat is going to cause that disturbance. Now, the diversity of an area can change even in that short-term scale, right? Some predators move in and out at night, so just to take advantage of the fact that nocturnal animals are around, perhaps they can use that to their advantage. Seasonally, snow, you know, will make some animals hibernate. It might make weather conditions might make them migrate as well. Snow can influence the general exposure of really small animals as well. So if they're not hibernating, they're not really running around either. Now, species interactions also change considerably over a temporal scale with the ebb and flow of population numbers changing and things like that. So some species will die out, others will fill in their niche, others will migrate if changes occur in their own habitats. And all of these interactions are heavily influenced by the diversity in the region, which we just said changes significantly over these time periods. Now, abiotic factors, however, are the opposite. They don't change in ways that are as significant as the other categories. Most abiotic factors may change in the short term, sure, but that's less significant over the long term. This changes, though, in a really significant way if you're looking at an ecosystem over a really long time period. We're talking decades, for example. And to add to that, through climate change into the mix, and it's going to increase the rate at which some of these change. So we're seeing the abiotic changes drift into levels we aren't used to seeing at such shorter time frames. So if we return to our original statement, what we are aiming to do is compare ecosystems using the abiotic factors, the species interactions, and the SDI. We are doing that in the context of or across temporal and spatial scales. Okay, so basically, how do these three things here change if we continuously sample them either over a time scale or a spatial scale? So that wraps that up.